I'd like to apologize for some of the technical difficulties that resulted in our Skype call with him not being as smooth as it could have been. So there is a little bit of a interference with the call, but we persevered as much as possible, and we have an assurance that Baba Buntu will be back to expound upon this most important subject at a later date. But we thought it was important enough to share it with you anyway. So here it is, by Kings and Queens, Baba Buntu on practical Pan-Africanism. Tendai Mwari. Okay, Tendai Mwari, Kings and Queens, you're tuning into Africa Speaks with Al Kebulan on Galaxy Radio, the only de-brainwashing station. And we are joined all the way live from Azania, South Africa, by our international superstar Pan-Africanist, Baba Buntu. Greetings, Tendai Mwari,
Tendai Mwari,
Baba Buntu.
greetings and Izwelethu, the land belongs to Africa.
Africa.
Greetings to all Galaxy listeners and all Africans globally.
Yes, indeed, Baba. Now we have you on to deal with the most important topic, and that is the subject of practical Pan-Africanism. And we was inspired to do this because we saw that you were ministering in this on this particular subject matter in South Africa recently. And we're always looking for ways to make our political ideologies more practical. Let me ask you first and foremost, what inspired you to put together such a presentation or workshop?
Well, thank you so much for the question. I think first and foremost, Pan-Africanism has always inspired me. I think the ideas, the ideologies, the concepts, the philosophies that are engraved in Pan-African writings from and practices from Garvey to so many others that have given us a script of what Pan-Africanism can and must be. I
Yes.
think I've chosen to carry that as not just as intellectual baggage that I can use to flaunt and posture and try to present myself as somebody who has a big head. I think more for me it's a reminder of the humble and the practicality that we need to implement it with. And I think, I always refer back to Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey.
Yes.
When I feel that I'm stuck on ideas, when I feel things are not moving, and I think that I'm having it hard, and I look at what Garvey was facing and what he went through,
Yeah.
and how he always found, how he was always thinking big at the same time as he was listening to what people were saying, maybe not always articulating, but saying through their actions, through their aspirations, and through the things that they were going through as challenges at the time.
Yes.
And I think when I do that, I'm reminded that yes, I have challenges in my life. We have challenges as organizations, but I think we also have a more robust possibility. We are speaking now thousands of miles away, and we can connect. We can inspire each other. I
Yes.
don't have to travel for days to meet you, and then that is a possibility in itself. And I feel that my main inspiration for this topic is that I feel as African people, we are not serving and honoring Mama Africa the way she expects us to, and we need to get with the program.
So, Baba Buntu, the subject might sound important to many of us here, because for many critics inside and outside of the Pan-Africanist movement, the idea of practicality is not an idea that is generally associated with Pan-Africanism or Pan-Africanists. Would you say that is a viable or justifiable perception, or is it an unjustified perception?
I do not agree with that position at all, but I am aware of it, and I understand that too, in a limited way, it also has a place. I think it is important that we have thinkers, that we have philosophies, that we have even conferences where we think about strategy, where we understand positions and
Yes.
philosophies, when we understand who we are. I mean, all of those conversations are very important for our intellectual growth and ideas. I think that's there's a beautiful aspect to it. But I think what upsets me is that we have, I want us to be responsible here. I feel that to a certain extent, we have allowed Pan-Africanism to become almost only an intellectual construct of ideas. And when we have put a lot of great ideas on the table or in a book, we walk away feeling we have done the work. And I feel that, no, that's just making an agenda for what's to come.
Yes.
And I think what's to come should be even more important than how to design going there, if you understand what I'm saying.
Yes, sir.
Meaning that when we have put the script down, that's when the work starts. That's when we put these things into committees. That's when we put this into task teams. That's when we put this into timelines. That's when we put the...
Okay, we've got a little bit of a problem with the Skype.
This into budget allocations, and we get on with the program. I cannot even be upset with young people who say they don't understand Pan-Africanism and they don't relate to it. Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Go ahead.
Hello?
Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I cannot even be upset with young people, young Africans who are saying they don't understand Pan-Africanism and they don't really see the value of it, because we are not doing a very good job at demonstrating how it works. And if we think about it, people tend to embrace ideas that they can see work. So if we are not, I'm not saying we're not trying, because a lot of people are trying and a lot of people are involved in this as well. I'm not saying it's not being done, but I just say it's not done sufficiently.
Yeah.
And if Pan-Africanism appears to be this space of just talking and philosophizing about ideas, about how to do stuff, but not actually doing it,
yeah,
then I can't be upset with young people for saying this doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
So I think there's a skewed a reality here where Pan-Africanism has been allowed to become this a discussion amongst intellectuals and not necessarily be highlighted in the proper way that it should as a practice.
Interesting. All right, before we get into the meat or the veg, so to speak, of the subject, we are doing this as a part of our ALD season, our Africa Liberation Day season. This is part 5 and a worthy conclusion to the season, I must add. But I want to know if there are any observances taking place in South Africa for Africa Liberation Day.
Sorry, just repeat that question.
I was asking.
Hello?
If yes, can
please
you
repeat the question? Yeah.
Yes, Baba.
I was asking if
there are any observances taking place in South Africa for Africa Liberation Day.
Oh yes. Well, there are a number of marking of Africa Liberation Day and month as such. I mean, the South African government has declared May as Africa Month.
Right.
Which you know has some nice aspects to it, but I feel that the sad part of that is that it often then just turns into government sponsored fluffy presentations where we just have a little bit of dance, a little bit of speeches that are not really going anywhere, and we clap hands and then we feel we are celebrating Africa,
mm-hmm,
which I don't think Africa Liberation Day is supposed to be about.
Yes, sir.
So I wouldn't say that there's a lot of events marking the day, but there are some attempts in several communities to highlight the day and to also put some substance into reflecting where are we as an African nation.
All right, well, let's put the substance to it now, Baba Buntu, in terms of practical,
yes,
Pan-Africanism. And I see in terms of what you have to speak on, it's first and foremost the importance of understanding power. Let's break that down for us, Baba Buntu.
Okay, so this is how I see it. As African people, we have walked for a very long time and existed for a very long time on this planet, and we have had many challenges. We have had many periods where we have lost what we achieved, where we have struggled with how to maintain our knowledge, our technologies, our sciences, and all of that. But we have always risen. We have always found solutions, and I believe that the time we live in now is probably the first time that we seem completely stuck. I mean, if you look at this, it seems like we are not really moving at all. It seems we're just talking about moving, but we're not really making progress. And that, to me, if I look at what makes the last 500 years, this particular challenge that we're dealing with now, different than other challenges that we have faced before, is that this one is so deeply about power, hegemonic global power. And if we don't understand power, it's going to be difficult for us to stand up to the system that has designed for us to fall. Mm-hmm. When we say that Africa and Africans are failing to, and then we fill in to have democracy, to have good leaders, to have a viable economy, things like that, mm-hmm. it's not that we are just failing. There's a design that is supposed to make sure that we don't rise.
Yes.
So we need to understand, and I have outlined three aspects of power that I think it's very important that we use Pan-Africanism to bring to create answers to. One is the power to unite, the other one is the power to deconstruct, and the third one is the power to build. I will just say something very quickly about each one.
Yes, sir.
The power to unite means these are actually achievable powers even if we don't have a lot of resources. It's not forbidden to unite as African people. There's no law against it. There might be many pressures and many ways of discouraging unity and many ways of trying to make sure that unity doesn't work.
Yes.
But it's not illegal, and there's nothing that really, 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 really stops us from a position of having a will to unite. And if we have that will, it means that it will actually present itself not just as flowery speeches in conferences, because we keep talking about unity. Unity will actually be something that results in us working towards an economic superpower. It will present itself in us working together constructively on a daily basis. So the power to unite is a very important aspect of that.
Mm-hmm.
Remember that by us losing and misunderstanding and losing the understanding of land, God, and mind, that has put us in a very dangerous position. We are dangerous to ourselves.
Right. God, land, and mind.
That's right. God, land, and mind. Those are three very important aspects of us for our purpose. Without land, without God, without mind, it's completely impossible for an African to formulate a useful purpose.
Yes.
So it's important that we bring these understandings back. That's the power to unite. Secondly, the power to deconstruct, meaning we need to grapple with issues and break them down into pieces. We can't just say we want a great black economy. What does it take to do that?
Right.
How do we set that up? Who does that? And what are the things that we can do? What are the things that we struggle to do?
Mm-hmm.
Are we making plans? Are we positioning ourselves to carry those plans out? So we need to deconstruct, because we live with a lot of constructed power walls that keep making us to fail. Thirdly, power to build, meaning having an understanding of how we use strategy, how we use spirituality, and how we use our operations. And I will get into that just in a moment.
Yeah.
But my point here is just to say we need to, Pan-Africanism to me must be a template or templates. I'm not against having a diversity of ideas around this as well.
Yes.
But it must deliver tools that we can use to create the power to unite, the power to deconstruct, and the power to build. And why I'm choosing these three aspects is, if you think about it, all of these aspects are at least in certain ways, maybe not fully, but in certain ways available to us,
right,
within our families, within our communities, within us coming up with practical ideas for schooling for our children, when it comes to setting up economic systems, when it comes to setting up a farm and toil the land. These things are actually possible to do. So, and that's where I want to keep the discussion, because yes, we want everybody in the whole world, every African person, to sit around the same, table of communication and interaction, but that might not happen tomorrow. So I want to deal with the things that we can do now.
Okay. Now some might say these things are easier said than done, because if they were so easy, we would have been doing them. What do you say to that, Mama?
No, I agree. I think part of why we tremble with our solutions is that we have been with these problems and these challenges for such a long time that we almost take them as normal. It's normal when we see black failure. It's normal when we see black people antagonize and fight. It's normal when we see black people not being able to unite. We have seen much more of that than to see us actually doing what we must.
Yeah.
So for me, we need to locate that in a will. I'm not sure if all of us has the will to create this power that we need as African people. I think many of us have the wish, many of us have the dream, many of us have the thought, many of us have the concept, and we do it, and we have those concepts and ideas very eloquently. But I'm not sure if every one of us have the will, because if we have, if I have the will to do this, it will completely mark how I live my daily life. It's not something that I talk about when Shakara Tafadzwi, Tafadza, when he invites me on radio. Yeah. It's something that you should find me doing 11 o'clock p.m., yeah. 10 a.m. Yeah. Anytime you come unannounced to visit me, this is what you should find me doing. Yeah. So I think it's really about us taking a position. And you know, Tafadza, I cannot... I have to start somewhere. I have to start with me. Yeah. I have to start with the family that I'm part of. I have to start with the community that I represent. If I'm not doing anything there, I don't really see the reason why I should travel far to go to a conference to give cute speeches if I don't practice what I teach. I think that's a questionable, type of leadership. Yeah. And my community should hold me responsible. They should hold me accountable to that. Why are you talking so much? Why are you not doing more?
Most definitely. All right. That leads nicely onto our second stage, which is Pan-African power sources. So once we've developed the, I'm assuming it goes like, once we've developed the ability to unite, deconstruct and build, what we build is therefore Pan-African power sources. Is that correct?
That's right.
Expand, Baba.
And the Pan-African power sources. Yes. So the next level then is, where do we draw our powers from? Where do they sit? Where do we find them? How do we bring them into existence? Operation will symbolize by the hand. I will explain. Strategic power means.
Sorry, Baba. We kind of lost you there for a sec. If you could rewind to the beginning of when you answer. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yes. Okay. So we're talking about the Pan-African power sources. Yes. Where do we take our power from? How do we bring power into existence? Yes. And I'm looking at three ways we can and must do that. One is strategic power, and I'm symbolizing that with the mind. Second, spiritual power. I'm symbolizing that with the heart.
Right.
Thirdly, operational power, and I'm symbolizing that with the hand. I will explain. Mm-hmm. Strategic power, the mind. Are we really shaping our minds full of incredible practical ideas? And if we are not, what am I doing to fill in the blanks? So if I talk, for instance, if I talk a lot about how we must set up an African-centered school.
Okay, brothers and sisters, we've got a little bit of a technical right there. We're going to try and get Baba Buntu back as soon as possible. As you can hear, he's breaking it down very, very beautifully right about now in terms of how we can make our Pan-Africanism more a practical, excellent feedback and breakdown so far. So we're going to be getting some advice into how we get over that mental blockage that stops us from building the school after we begin to speak about it. Kings and queens, you are tuned into Galaxy Radio. Africa Speaks with Al Kebaland, the only de-brainwashing station, and we are addressing the subject of practical Pan-Africanism. Baba Buntu?
Hello?
I can hear you. Good.
This is so frustrating.
I know, I'm sorry, I apologize.
No, you can't even apologize. It's almost like somebody sitting here just designing for this not to work, because I've had such a good connection the whole day.
Hello? Yeah, that's why we need practical Pan-Africanism, so we can build our own Skype.
exactly.
Yes, sir. All right, we'll persevere for as long as we can.
Yeah. True.
What's it? So you started by saying something about a school, building a black school. And getting over the mental, getting to the from the theoretical to the practical.
Right. So this, actually, to use another language, I could say this is about our power fitness. Are we fit to take on the power that we need to enact our ideas? Right. So when it comes to the mind, am I equipping myself? Am I exercising my mind? And am I being aware of my blind spots? Am I being aware of what I keep talking talking about but not doing. Because if I'm not, I will become dysfunctional. I will become somebody who just talks about great ideas, but I don't enact them. Mm-hmm. So it's not just about what I put into my mind, but what I do with what I put into the mind and what kind of things that I engage with.
Yeah.
So that's the strategic power. Then the spiritual power. And this is not, this depends, you know, we are a diverse African people, let's just agree. Spirituality means that for me to work in my community and do something practical, mm-hmm. I need to have a deep sense of African love for my people.
Mm-hmm.
And that means I need to engage emotionally, psychologically, with my determination. I cannot say I will work with other black people if they support me. Mm-hmm. I will work with other black people if they love me. I will work with other African... Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. I can hear you.
So spiritual power is then a position that I'm taking emotionally and psychologically that I am going to work for my people. Mm-hmm. Knowing that I might not always be acknowledged. I might not always be liked. I might not always be given the credit that maybe my ego wishes that I could have. This is a position that I'm taking because I love my people. And I understand that we are a wounded people in many ways.
Mm-hmm.
And that sometimes the people that I wish to speak nicely and lovely to me might not do that. And might even walk away from what I do. And I make a commitment that even when people walk away, I'm not going to give up. I'm just going to change and learn how to change my methodology mm-hmm. so that I can do what I feel I'm called to do.
Mm-hmm.
So that is spiritual power, the ability to integrate metaphysical, ancestral, and even ritual realities.
Yes.
And of course, this means different things to people, because you know some of us are so brainwashed that we get scared when we hear words like this.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's also about understanding that rituals in the African sense were not put there for magic. They were not put there for strange things. They were put there for very practical purposes.
Right.
If we are a people who hurt each other a lot, there's a ritual way that we need to cleanse that. We cannot just talk about, we shouldn't do this, we must stop being hurtful to each other.
Right.
If we are, and if we keep hurting each other and upsetting each other and violating each other, we must also find ways to cleanse away from
Baba
that.
Bunchy,
and that gives us power. It sets power free.
This is very interesting what you're saying, because for many people, when they hear practical, what you're outlining here, sounds very much the opposite of practical. It sounds like you're trying to suspend us in a worship experience, you know what I'm saying? And many people don't see the practicality of spirituality. For those who would have that critique, what would you say?
Thank you so much for the question. And I know that many of us have our guards up against spirituality, at least for two things. One, that we have been forced into a very particular form of spiritual practice,
right.
which often comes in the form of Christendom and other religions that were imposed on us.
Mm-hmm.
So when we have an awakening, maybe we want to actually leave the whole realm of spirituality altogether.
Right.
And I think secondly, because there are people who also take advantage of our vulnerability as Africans. So even those, there are people who also come masked as spiritual Africans, spiritual warriors, who can save us from all this Eurocentricity and all of that. But they are not doing it for the genuine reasons.
Mm-hmm.
So here I'm not talking about spirituality in the sense of forming or belonging to a particular, let me call it doctrine or a particular gospel or a particular way of praying or anything like this. What I'm saying is able to work with each other. The easiest way that I can exemplify that is when I talk about African love. Love in the sense of not romantic love, but love in the sense of loving my people,
right.
which is a political position that I'm taking,
right.
knowing that I might not get praised, I might not always be welcomed, but I commit.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an example of a spirituality that doesn't have anything to do with particular prayers or particular rituals.
Yes.
But it becomes ritualistic in the sense that I put myself before my people. I study my people so that I understand what this woundedness has done. And I still stand. I still reach out. I still engage because I believe in this. That's so there's a faith aspect to that. I have faith in my people, even if they don't always give me an easy reason to have it.
Yes, yes. Interesting. All right. That would directly speak to then our ability to work with each other. To be able to engage in rituals of healing is practical in the sense that it works. It increases our workability, is what I hear you say.
That's right. And secondly, because you know we have many beautiful beginnings of projects. I mean, I think we've all been to the inauguration or the launch of an incredible project, and it's beautiful for a couple of months, maybe even a couple of years,
yes.
And then it starts to go sour.
Yes.
How many of us have been part of the same organization for more than 10 years?
Yes.
How many of us have stood loyally fighting, even if it's not a perfect organization, to say that I'm going to be here until I see that it really works. I'm not going to leave.
Yeah.
Many of us have been to organizations for a year, for 2 years, and we leave because we are already exhausted.
Yes, yes.
So it's all also about sustainability. That was my point.
Okay, no, that is a beautiful point, and I'm sure one that speaks to the reality of many of our listeners. So we give thanks for that. Searching and precise and incisive questions that you're asking there, Baba Buntu. All right, let's go on to our third pillar, which is examples of how to implement Pan-African practicality. Let's expand upon that a little bit.
Okay, we will do that, but I just want to mention quickly that next to strategic power and spiritual power, we also have the operational power.
Oh, sorry,
which
I
symbolize.
Yes, go ahead. Thank you.
No problem. So in addition to strategic power and spiritual power, we also have the operational power,
yes,
which I symbolize with the hand.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope you also noticed that I've used very simplistic symbols here, saying the mind must connect with the heart,
yes,
and
sir,
that again must connect with the hand.
Yes, sir.
So there must be a flow where these three elements of my consciousness actually work in collaboration.
Yes, sir.
So the hand will then be the symbol of the ability to position my skills, to organize, to reach out to people, to mobilize people, to make sure that people actually come to the things that we say we do, or that I find myself going out to the communities that need to be reached.
Mm-hmm.
And understanding how to implement something. So this is our planning. This is how we evaluate. This is how we operate, how we make sure that things work and how we sustain them.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the third part of the sources of power. Then thirdly, we go into the examples of how to implement Pan-African practicality.
Yes.
And I want to mention some examples. I want to mention those that I feel we don't speak so much about. And when I single out some, it's not to say that these are the only ones we should focus on. But I want to start with self and family. We are a people who, for thousands of years, have worked very hard on having our culture, our purpose of life, our ethos linked and accentuated through our families.
Mm-hmm.
Our families, the family is the first school that we enter in life.
Mm-hmm.
So if we now have become a people, and I'm not saying this goes for everyone, let's not get stereotypical here,
yes,
but I think it's not a myth, it's not a lie that we know that many African families struggle. They struggle with taking care of each other, inspiring each other, loving each other, be loyal to each other. We struggle.
Right.
We have many examples of pain that are exercised in our homes.
Yes.
Our homes should be, think about this, and I'm thinking especially to the audience that might find themselves in UK. When you leave your house, you're going out into a world that wants to cut you down. It
yeah.
wants to discourage you. It wants to make you believe that you are small, so small and so insignificant that you should even give up before you try. That's what the world you are facing every single day. So if we, inside of the houses that we live, also have weak structures, also allow ourselves to talk to each other in very demeaning ways, feel fatigued and tired and depressed before we can even reach the door handle to go out,
mm.
what kind of people are we going to be?
Mm.
So the home must be a guided space. There's certain ways we don't talk at home. There's certain things that cannot happen in our homes. There's certain guidelines for how a family takes care of each other.
Right.
Has an interest in every member, builds each other, encourage every member when they keep falling, and rise together as a strong unit.
Yes.
For me, that's a very important example of how we build African power.
Yes.
So
this
goes into relationships, this goes into marriage, this goes into intergenerational conflict that many African families are experiencing. And I want to say something about this.
Yeah, go ahead.
Shakara, I think you know very well that for some reason we are kind of allowed the family space to be very, very private.
Yes.
So issues that happens within the family is not something we should talk about, or sometimes we don't even seek much advice about it because we feel so ashamed if we are not living up to the expectations that a family should represent.
Mm.
And I feel we are doing ourselves such a disfavor. We must understand that the weaknesses that we often see within our families is not a result of us being weak. It's a result of us being so marginalized, so pressed, so oppressed, so pressurized, so pushed to the margin that is to gain strength, to build each other and set ourselves up to be changed when we leave that house and go out in the world. So that's one example.
You know what, can we stay here for a sec on this family thing? Because it's very,
yes,
very, very
yes,
important.
Please.
In the sense of, it might, another critique of the movement, so to speak, of the Pan-African movement, might be that there hasn't been enough of a focus on family. For example, there's a critique over here in the UK in terms of in the Pan-African community, how often you see couples in committed relationships together on the road or together in organizations. And it would suggest that, coming back to what you were saying at the beginning, that there's been a heightened focus on political ideology and theory and probably not enough on family. On the importance of family in the development of a movement or an organization.
Hello.
Ah, I can hear you good. Can you hear me?
Okay, let's go.
Yeah, go ahead. All right,
I can hear you.
Yes, sir. I don't know where you got cut off, but you're talking about families.
So yes, that's right. So the reason I focus so much on the African family is also because we are a company here in Tanzania that has put the African family and its protection, its guidance, and its power at the center of every activity we do. So if we talk about entrepreneurship, we always have a link to family. If we talk about spirituality, we always link it to family. If we talk about power, if we talk about intellectualism, if we talk about production, whatever, we always link it to family. Family is the main building structure of African culture. Mm-hmm. And if we don't have powerful families, we cannot achieve what we say that we want to do. That doesn't mean that everyone has to be married. It doesn't mean that everyone must have five children, but it means that we need to be cognizant of the fact that we are struggling with familyhood right now.
Right.
And we can actually be creative to form different forms of family. We can connect better. We can take care of those who have not necessarily found a family that is functional to them. And when I'm saying that, I mean some people, when they wake up to an African consciousness, they become very lonely because their family don't understand them. Some people, when they choose certain ways of living as an African, they become an outcast in their family, so they don't feel they belong anymore. But that means that it means at least two things. It means that our organizations must also function as families. So we must get involved in our members' lives. We must provide tools and encouragement and solutions for the stuff that we have kind of called private and individual and that should not be discussed in Pan-African places.
Mm.
I completely disagree with that notion and I want us to move on it quickly.
Yes.
Secondly, we also need to give tools and ways of approaching these problematic spaces to young people who want to enter a relationship, who want to be parents, who want to see themselves being part of building a home.
Yes.
Are we giving them tools how to do this in an African way? Are we taking care of them as they struggle and grapple with whatever goes through, what they go through inside of a relationship? Are we giving... We need to really exercise some courage. And that takes me back to maybe my concluding point. We do not have access to all the power that we need to get to where we really need to go. Because there's too many forces that are keeping us locked and marginalized and oppressed. But that doesn't mean that all power is completely unavailable to us. And we must take the power that we can build within our communities, within our families, within ourselves. And we must use that to find to develop the tools, but being busy every single day to implement them.
Yo, this is Swiss Soul Solid. Africa speaks with our cable and Galaxy 102.5. Blaze the fire, fire, fire.
Yes, indeed, Tendai Mwari, kings and queens, this is Africa Speaks with Al Kebalan on the Big G Galaxy Radio. You just heard from our international guest, Baba Buntu from Zania, South Africa, addressing the concept of practical Pan-Africanism, kings and queens. Once again, apologies that the interview was kind of cut short based upon the limitations of the Skype at the time, but we will be dealing with that again. But how Baba said, so much that we could look into and that we need to develop on as Pan-Africanism, becoming more practical. And it's very interesting. What interested me most about that particular interview is that when he's dealing with Pan-Africanism and practical Pan-Africanism, he went to the area of family, and that's an area that is so often neglected. But if we look on it in terms of, we keep saying that family is the basis of a nation, yeah, and so really and truly the quality of our nation building and our community development is going to be based around the strength of the families that we build. So that it doesn't really get much more practical than that. He brought down some concepts in terms of having, you know, the head and the heart and the hand working in unison, you know what I'm saying? In terms of the mind, the soul and the body, operation, strategy and spirituality and all these kinds of things, kings and queens. It was a most important interview. So we give thanks to Baba Buntu for that contribution, and we look forward to hosting him again, whereby he will be able to break down those concepts even further. And I've you know, offered my services to him so that we can share in terms of the developing of this particular concept in terms of collaboration, kings and queens. Pan-African collaboration is most definitely taking place.